So the four lectures which I'm going to give is loosely titled as Action in Classical and Quantum Physics. So this title was given because I couldn't think of a better title. So it is not that I'm going to talk about action principles in various cases in classical mechanics, quantum mechanics, etc., which is something which you will anyway be learning either in MSc or in later stages of BSc. The idea was to present something else using action as the anchor. So let me first explain to you what the lecture is all going to be. By and large, when we study physics, there is a very streamlined historical approach. You start with classical mechanics, then you do classical electrodynamics, then somebody tells you there is something called special relativity, and then there is general theory of relativity, then there is quantum mechanics, and then there is quantum field theory. So if you persist with it, you will end up learning all this. But this is all done in pieces, and it is very often very difficult for a student or even a teacher to get a unified grasp of the thing. So the purpose of these four lectures is to give you an overview of the structure of theoretical physics, and I am just going to use action as the basis for that. This is because we do not know of a single fundamental law in physics, and even some non-fundamental laws in physics, which cannot be derived from something called an action principle. So what is an action principle? The action principle essentially says, if you have a system, you can write down a particular quantity for that system called the action, which depends on the dynamical variables of the system. And then you can describe the entire physics of the system, either the quantum mechanical version or relativistic version or non-relativistic version or classical version, just using this principle. Okay? So we do not know an exception to this rule. So it is a good way to start thinking about physics, and that is what these four lectures will do. So even right at the beginning, when I mentioned these terms, there is this action which you have to be defined for every system. And also, it has to be defined in terms of what is called the dynamical variables of this system. Now, you might think that dynamical variables are very trivial and we know what the dynamical variables are. Actually, you are wrong. In fact, we don't know what the dynamical variables of the nature are. And in fact, most of physics, most of really high-end physics, involves in understanding what are the true dynamical variables of nature are. In some approximate sense, we know, but we don't understand it at a very fundamental level. And we don't know how to construct the action for a very general system in terms of the dynamical variable. So you find that this lecture can start off with some very elementary things and go to real frontier areas very quickly. And in the process, you will also learn a lot about the overall interrelationship between various things. And many of the derivations I'm going to give you, you won't find in textbooks. So even things which you know, I will approach it from a different point of view. But before I proceed further, I just need to get a rough balance. I know who are the participants in this lecture. But just to make sure, is there anyone here who do not know Maxwell's equations? Just raise your hand. Okay, good. You don't know what is Maxwell's equation. You are in BSc or?
Engineering.
Oh, you are from engineering. Okay, so you just had to take it on faith. Okay, then almost all of you or most of you would have at least had a brief idea of what is a Lagrangian or an action. Are there people who don't know anything about what is a Lagrangian or action? You have been heard of these terms? Okay, great. And almost everybody will know, at least through these lectures here, that there is something called general relativity, and general relativity describes curved space-time. There is a metric tensor, etc. This must have been done in the class, right? Okay, these are the basic things which I need. So let me start by describing to you the overall structure of theoretical physics in a particular way, and then we will fill in the details. Since this is going to be a central theme, I will draw a picture here, and hopefully we will keep it there. So the way I'm going to do this is to take three axes, which I have called sometime as the cube of theoretical physics. So the one axis I will put the capital G, which is the Newtonian gravitational constant. On the other axis, I am going to put H cross, which is the Planck's constant. On the other axis, I am going to put the inverse of the speed of light, c to the minus 1, 1 by c. Okay? Now let us look at the origin. The origin corresponds to G is equal to 0, h cross is equal to 0 and c inverse is equal to 0. And also, since we have three mass length and time units, you can also rescale things so that h cross is 1, g is 1, and c inverse is 1. So there is a cube which I can draw here, okay? And that cube will contain all of physics depending on what I am going to tune. So let me explain that to you. Normally, when you learn classical mechanics, you are somewhere here. You don't introduce relativity, that is, you are assuming speed of light is infinity, and you are not going to introduce quantum mechanics, so h cross is 0. You may want to introduce g, because if you are talking about planetary motion in classical mechanics or something, you need some Newtonian gravity, but other than that, you don't do anything, so you just stick to this line, okay? Then somebody comes and tells you that there is something called special relativity. So what happens then? So let us draw this face of the cube. So this point, sorry, I got the wrong face. So I need, yeah, this is not a, let me draw all the faces, that would make it easier for you to understand. Okay, so think of this as a cube, okay? So you start from here, and then you ignore gravity, and then you go along this, and you introduce speed of light. This is, I will call it classical mechanics. This is what I would have called special relativity. This vertex is what I would have called special relativity. So you have particles, but the particles no longer obey Newton's laws of motion, but it obeys some special relativistic laws of motion. Relationship between momentum and energy is changed, etc., etc. That is what time dilation, space length contraction, all these happens here. This is at this vertex. Now you introduce gravity and special relativity. When you do that, you need to switch on G and you need to keep this also on. So you are going to this vertex and this vertex is GR. This is the general theory of relativity, because you very quickly understand that special theory of relativity is not compatible with Newtonian gravity. So when you go from the Newtonian gravity plane to here, you end up getting GR. So the entire classical physics you know is in this edge. What happens to electrodynamics? Electrodynamics in the most natural setting should be thought of as part of special relativity. I mean, there are several textbooks which will introduce special relativity as an afterthought after discussing Maxwell's equations, etc., and that is not a very nice way of doing things. So when I talk along this line, there is also electrodynamics somewhere here. So this is special relativity and electrodynamics. So you have electrodynamics, you have gravity, and then entire classical physics with h cross equal to 0 is contained in this phase. Now you can do one more thing. You can switch on h cross. And we play the same game. We keep one at a time. So let us take the speed of light to be infinity. So we stick at the origin. And from the classical mechanics, I just go along the h cross line. So what you get here is the quantum mechanics. So you start from classical mechanics, and you can get to quantum mechanics. This is, again, a slightly wrong way of doing things, because nature never does it like that. Nature never quantizes a system, because nature is fully quantum mechanical. What human beings do is to classicalize a quantum system. So nature is here, and we guys are here, and we do the approximation along this line, and that is how we describe the world, okay? So this is truer than this. But of course, here we have only switched on one constant, and what happens when you add special relativity to quantum mechanics? Then you end up getting something called quantum field theory. All of the physics you see in LHC, for example, all the standard model of physics, all the particle physics interactions, everything which you learn in elementary particle physics, other than gravity, is confined here. So in fact, this plane provides a very good practical description of nature. Once you know the standard model of physics, special relativity, and quantum mechanics, for example, all of chemistry is covered. All of medicine coming from chemistry or biochemistry is covered. And hopefully, you will be able to understand all of nature where gravity doesn't play any role on this plane. So you have this plane, which is classical physics, and this plane is non-gravitational in nature. Now we can ask what happens when you switch on G. So there, if you have quantum mechanics and switch on G, and you keep the relativity away, then you get something which I will call gravitational quantum mechanics. This is not something which is talked about in textbooks, but I am going to use it very quickly, almost at the end of this lecture or next lecture, and you will find that it gives you very valuable insights. Okay, so we'll come back to this. This is not something which you will find in textbooks and this and that. This is not a subject. All the other things, GR, SR, ED, CM, QM, and QFT are textbook syllabuses. Okay? But you wouldn't have seen a GQM in any syllabus of any university. But it is a useful point, but let us keep it there. Now you switch on all the three, and as far as we understand, that is, I'll loosely call it QG, which is the domain where you want to put in the principles of general relativity and quantum theory together, and that is what is called quantum gravity. And this is something which we really don't understand, but there is a subset of it. So maybe I should draw a rectangle here and chop off this much. You don't really hit there, but you go close to it, where you can think of quantum fields, so quantum mechanics has come in, and general relativity, but you don't try to quantize gravitational fields. And this is what Stephen Hawking did, for example, where you study black holes and you study quantum fields around black holes, and then there is something called the thermodynamics of the black hole, entropy of black holes, etc. All of them involve the two constants, three constants, H cross, C, and G. So in that sense, it is sitting in this vertex, but you are still not talking about the full quantum theory of gravity. Okay, so this is the overall structure of theoretical physics which we have. Now we want to go into details. So let us start with this and ask, how do we describe this? So let us take a first, a very elementary approach, and let us ask, what do we do in classical mechanics or in classical physics itself? So what is classical physics made of? Now if this is, we are now talking about the physics of the 19th century, before 1900, before relativity and quantum mechanics came on, special relativity and quantum mechanics came on. So at that time, how did people describe classical mechanics or the classical dynamics? Well, it was fairly easy. First, they had this equation which said that mass into acceleration, which I will write as x double dot. So if I put a tilde at the bottom, it is a vector. Dot represents time derivative. So this is the mass into acceleration. This is given by an external force. Now, until I tell you what the force is, this is fairly much useless. And in classical physics, people knew about two forces. One force is the gravitational force, which goes as m times g, which can be written as minus m times gradient of a gravitational potential. One more force is the electromagnetic force, which is F, which is Q into E plus V cross B, where E and B are the electromagnetic, electric field and magnetic field. So one notation, one point about notation throughout the lecture, I'm not going to worry too much about whether this is V or V by C, et cetera, and whether I'm using MKS or SICGS, because most of what we are going to do is not going to be at that nitty gritty level. And you just imagine that these constants are supplied. Okay, I'm more interested in the overall conceptual structure. So these are the two equations, and you can plug either one of them on that side, and then you can solve this, and you will know how a particle moves in a gravitational field or a particle moves in an electromagnetic field. But that is not the whole story. Now somebody has to tell you what this phi is and what is E and B are. Well, that you can do. You can write two more equations. For gravitational field, you write the equations curl of G is equal to zero, which is same as saying G is a gradient, so it is nothing new. And then you say that divergence of G is minus 4 pi times capital G times the mass density rho. Here, if you plug in this minus del phi, you will get an equation del square phi is 4 pi G rho, which is just Poisson equation, which you would know from electrostatics, But the gravitational field also obeys exactly that equation. Newtonian gravitational field obeys exactly that equation. So if you are talking about particles moving just in gravitational field, this end, then this equation plus this equation is the whole story. You take a whole bunch of particles, you compute the gravitational field produced by these particles, and then you solve how these particles are moving, and then you backtrack. In fact, cosmological numerical simulations of zillions of particles in the universe does exactly that. You don't need anything further if you are only talking about particles which are moving under gravitational field. And you can solve it in a computer. And this is what you do when you form structures of galaxies, etc., etc. Now, you have the next set, which is the electric and magnetic field. So you also need to write down the equations of motion for the electric and magnetic fields. Okay? In general, of course, the electric and magnetic fields are produced by charges and currents. So the equations separate themselves into two nice sets. One set which is independent of charge and current. So there is a divergence, so B is equal to 0. And the other equation is that curl of E is minus B dot. So curl is 1 by x, so it is 1 by length. This is 1 by time. The equation is dimensionally wrong. The reason it is dimensionally wrong is I haven't put C factors, and I am going to set C is equal to 1 hereafter. The earlier you get accustomed to it, the better, so I will do it like that. So this equation is true. Whatever is your charges and currents in your lab, then you have two more equations. One is divergence of E equals either rho by epsilon naught if you are an SI guy, or it is 4 pi times rho if you use Gaussian system. I will simply write rho. I'll just assume rho has been rescaled. Okay. And similarly, you can write an equation for curl of B minus E dot equals J. J is the current. Again, there are numerical factors which I have ignored. I don't care because I'm going to put these two to zero immediately. So these equations plus this completely tells you how charged particles are moving in this system. Okay? This is how classical mechanics or classical dynamics in this region, closer to this, is being thought about. Okay? Now this thinking is completely wrong, and I'll tell you where all things go wrong in a minute. But before that, let us ask, what are we doing here? I mean, what is the aim of these equations? Here is where the notion of dynamical variables come in. Roughly speaking, the aim in doing this kind of physics is to study the evolution of dynamical variables. So that requires you to define what is a dynamical variable. You cannot give a rigorous definition. You cannot give a rigorous and useful definition. But at each situation, the situation will dictate for you what is a convenient and useful set of variables. For example, if you take this equation and some external force is given, like the force, the gravitational force of the sun is given, and you are interested in studying the motion of a planet around the sun, then a natural dynamical variable is the position of the planet, which is three functions of x. So the dynamical variable in that context will be x as a function of t. Right? Now, of course, Earth is being treated as a point particle here, but if you are going to study some geological phenomena, then obviously this is not the correct dynamical variable to use. And similarly, if you are talking about a cantilever stuck to a wall and you are vibrating it, the position of the edge of the cantilever is a good dynamical variable. If you are talking about the oscillation of a pendulum, the position of the bob, that angular variable, is a good dynamical variable. But if you are going to start talking about how the internal stresses and strain of the elastic rod is changing, then the position of the edge of the rod is not a good dynamical variable. So as you probe deeper and deeper, the nature of dynamical variables will change. But loosely speaking, at this level of physics, positions of particles are a good dynamical variable. If there are several particles, you stick an I here or an A here, where A goes 1, 2, 3, n. Okay, so you can study n particles as easily as one particle once you can write down the equation. Easily in principle. But what are the dynamical variables of electromagnetic field? Now, this is almost never talked about in the sense that we don't use this language when you talk about Maxwell's equation. That is the first thing I want to do. Dynamical variables by and large satisfy one unique phenomena in the physics. There are exceptions to it, but by and large this is true. These are functions of time and they obey equations which are second order in time. So, x is a function of time and the fundamental equation obeyed by x is second derivative in time. So, this happens to be a very universal feature. Why do dynamical equations obey second order equation? Y is in the Fourier's law, mass times x dot equals f. Aristotle used to think that is the thing, that if you shoot an arrow, in order to keep the arrow moving with constant velocity, you have to push at it. Stands to reason, because otherwise the arrow falls down. But now we understand it is because of friction, etc., and you don't need such a law. It only cares about the acceleration. On the other hand, why could it have been fourth derivative or third derivative? We have absolutely no clue. All of physics, dynamical variables obey the second time derivative in that variables. Of course, you may say that if it obeys fourth time derivative, then it take the second time derivative of that and call it a dynamical variable. You can play tricks like this, but by and large, the most natural dynamical variables which you use or the most useful dynamical variables you use obeys second time derivative differential equation. This is a universal feature. It is all over, okay? All over the cube of physics, this statement is true. So, what are the dynamical variables in electromagnetism if you approach it like this? So, that is what I want to do first. Now, in order to do that, there is a very useful trick which you can introduce when there are divergences and curls, okay? And especially when the equations are linear. One thing you realize is that this is, of course, independent of charges and current, so you can solve it trivially, which we will do in a minute. In fact, let me write it down. Because divergence of B is equal to 0, B is going to be a curl of some other quantity, which is defined by this relation. You call it A. And then you plug it into this and then work a little bit. You will find that curl of something is 0, that has to be a gradient, and you will find that this is given by, E is given by A dot minus gradient of phi, where phi is the electrostatic potential. So, if you are not familiar with it, I mean, some of you might have learned electrodynamics, but might not have learned what is a vector potential and scalar potential, just work it through. So, all throughout the talk, I'm going to give you exercises which you should try out if you are interested, or look it up in a book. So, B is curl of A and E is this, that takes care of these two equations, okay? So, these two equations are no big deal because that can be solved once and for all in terms of A and phi. Already you find that there are three vectors here, six vectors. We have reduced it to three vectors here and one phi, that is four. Now, it turns out that there is also further things which you can do with it, that there are something called gauge transformation by which it can be reduced further. But I will introduce it in a particular way because at this stage I want to move rapidly to the dynamical variables business. So, whenever you have, then you have only these two equations to take care of. And these equations also involve divergences and curl. And whenever you have divergence and curl and the equations are linear in the sources, what do I mean by that? Suppose you have done this universally and then you go and plug E and B into this. Then you have an equation for A and phi. On the right hand side there is a rho and j. Suppose somebody first gives you a rho 1 and j 1 and somebody else gives you rho 2 and j 2 and you know the solutions for each of them. Then you know the solution in the presence of rho 1 plus rho 2 and j 1 plus j 2 by just adding these solutions. That is what we mean by linearity because they are linear in J. Fortunately for us, Maxwell's equations, at least the low energy limit of electrodynamics, is linear in these equations. And when they are linear and they have curls and divergences, a very useful trick is to Fourier transform it. So what we are going to do is the following. Take this E, which is a function of time and space, and you Fourier transform it just in space. you write it as D3K over 2 pi the whole cube, that is just a convention, and you call it Ek of t e to the I k dot x. Okay, let us make sure you understand what I mean by this. You have a vectorial function of time and space. So at every point there is a Ex, Ey, Ez, and they all depend on t and x. So take Ex, Fourier transform it. So for Ex Fourier transform, to be very precise, I should have written it as t comma k, and the standard Fourier transform notation I should have put a tilde here. So this is the, if you take the x component, this is the x component's Fourier transform on this small x, which introduces k and e to the ik dot x. But it turns out to be much nicer to use this notation. You will see it in a minute. So I'm going to write it as Ek, where k is a subscript of t. So are you clear what I am doing here? First, I am only Fourier transforming in space. And when you Fourier transform in space, you get a set of functions here. These functions are labeled by k. To be very rigorous, I shouldn't use the symbol E here, but we know what we are doing in physics, so we will use E itself. So with a subscript, it is in Fourier space. If there is no subscript, it is in real space. This cannot depend on x because x dependence has been taken out. It still depends on time. Now suppose I give you this function Ek of t for every k. It's nice for you to think of k as some kind of a discrete index, even though it is a continuous index. Okay? So for every value of k, I give you this Ek of t. Then this Ek of t contains the same amount of information as E. And similarly, I can do for B. The beauty of this is that if you have things like curl or this operator, that operator get translates into I times the vector k in the Fourier space. What I mean by that is that you have a Fourier transform of E is Ek. Now if I take a curl of this, or take divergence first, divergence of this, the divergence operator will go through this integral because the integral is only on k, it doesn't depend on x. This doesn't depend on x. So divergence will act on e to the ik dot x. So divergence involves d by dx, d by dy, d by dz. Each one of them will bring down ikx, iky, ikz. So you will get this ik down. And that will get a dot product with this. So you have the rules. Curl is equal to ik cross. Divergence is equal to ik dot. Okay, there is something here that you put here also in the Fourier space. And if you had just gradient, it would have been just ik, but we don't need that. So you have these relations. And now I can write these equations here in Fourier space. Okay, but before I do that, I want to go back to this and simplify it a little bit. I'm going to assume that this equation is true, but I'm going to put two conditions on A, two conditions on the potential. First, I'm going to assume divergence of A is equal to 0, and then I'm going to assume phi is equal to 0, and I'm going to only study rho is equal to 0, j is equal to 0 case, that is free electromagnetic field. I want to identify what are the dynamical degrees of freedom of the free electromagnetic. So this actually works only in this case, but we won't go into that. So I have assumed these two. That is, I am assuming that B and E can be chosen like this with these extra conditions. How do I know that? Well, there are formal ways of proving it. You can show that if you first start with this and then do something called gauge transformation, you can always go to it. There is a much nicer way. You plug it in as an ANSAT and make sure whether you get consistent equation. If you get consistent equation which can satisfy everything, that is the end of the story. So now let us go back and look at these equations. So if this is the case, then in this limit, your electric field is going to be, so B is equal to curl of A is true, universally true, except for A being divergence free. But the electric field now is going to become minus A dot, because I have put phi is equal to 0. This is just rewriting this equation here. Now let us look at this equation. Rho is 0, so divergence of E should be 0. So I take divergence of E. Divergence of E is minus d by dt divergence of A, but divergence of A is 0, and its d by dt is also 0 by equations of motion. So if divergence of A is 0 at one instant, it will stay 0 at all instants. So there is a consistent condition which I can improve. So I had already taken into account this equation. This is also taken care of. So the only equation left is this. So let us see what that equation gives us. So you have curl of B, which is ik cross bk. What is bk? Bk is curl of A. So this is another ik cross ak. I can do the same Fourier transform trick for any vector. Then minus E dot. E dot is minus double derivative of this. So that is going to be plus ak double dot is equal to 0. So this I into I gives me a minus sign first. This is going to be k into del dot ak. What is del dot ak? Del dot ak is 0, because we assume divergence of A is equal to 0, which in turn implies in Fourier space that ik dot ak is 0, right? So k into divergence of that minus k square times ak, triple product rule. So that will give me k square times ak. So let me write this as ak double dot plus k square ak equals 0. This is a nice equation, so let us put a box around it. So the entire electrodynamics in the absence of charges and currents is reduced to this single equation. You solve this equation, then you construct your electric field by this, magnetic field like this. You do it in Fourier space, and then you do a Fourier transform, and you get it in the electric fields and magnetic field in real space. End of story. But what is very nice about this is that this AK satisfy a second order differential equation. So for every value of K, I can think of AK as the dynamical variable. So the dynamical variable of electromagnetic field is reduced to the vector potential, which is divergence free. So it has 2 degrees of freedom. So at every point, suppose you take AK, you take a value of k, in that value of k, A is living in the plane which is, this is the direction of k, and you take the plane which is perpendicular to this, A is living in that. That is a two-dimensional plane, so it has 2 degrees of freedom, which actually corresponds to 2 polarization states of the electromagnetic wave. So you have these 2 degrees of freedom at every k value, which translates into 2 degrees of freedom at every x value, and it satisfies the second order differential equation. But how many degrees of freedom are there? Infinite number of them. Because for every value of k, you have a dynamical variable, and there are infinite number of k values. Because k is kx, ky, kz, all values of k are allowed. But that you cannot help. This is equivalent to saying that if you take this A as a function of t and x, at every point x, there is something which is changing in time. And something which is changing in time is our dynamical variable. So at every point x, there is a dynamical variable, and there are infinite number of spatial points which gets converted into infinite number of k points in k space, and there are infinite number of degrees of freedom. But these are the degrees of freedom. But that looks very strange. I mean, it doesn't match with anything which we know. But what is actually going on here? What is actually going on here is extremely nice. In normal classical mechanics, you would have thought x and x dot as the dynamical variables. This is the position and this is the velocity. So if you want to integrate this equation of motion, I have to tell you what is the position and the velocity at a point, and then you integrate and you tell me the position and velocity at later time. So what is the corresponding thing in electromagnetism? It turns out that the corresponding thing in electromagnetism is the magnetic field and the electric field. Magnetic fields are like position of a particle, and electric fields are like the momentum of a particle. It's as simple as that. And this is something which you don't see unless you go through all this analysis. So let me show you where that comes from. Where that comes from is the following. We identified AK, the divergence-free AK, as the dynamical variable, right? Now let us go back to this equation and write it in Fourier space. Then you get BK is equal to IK cross AK. Now what does this mean? It means that if I take the K space, this is KX, KY, KZ, and you take a point here which is the K vector. At this point, there is a AK, BK, etc. sitting there. Now because AK is K cross something, B is going to be orthogonal both to A and to K, right? B is going to be perpendicular to K, so B has to be in, so to speak, in this plane. BK has to be in this plane. And it also has to be perpendicular to AK. So if I think of AK as sitting like this, then K cross AK will be in this direction, will be BK. So the same, because these are perpendicular to each other, if I look at the magnitude of BK, it is just K times AK. And the mod square of BK, because BK in general will be complex, BK mod square will be just K square times AK mod square. So AK and BK contain exactly the same amount of information because I know K, so I can just scale it out. So if AKs are the dynamical variables, so are BKs. So the actual dynamical variable is given by this. What is the derivative of the time derivative of the dynamical variable x dot? It is A dot. What is A dot? A dot is E. So the electric field is the other dynamical variable. Now what is this equation? Again, to begin with, this is 1 by time square because it is a double derivative in time. K, if you think of it as coming from K dot x, is 1 by length. So K square will be 1 by length square. What we are missing again is a factor C. So just to indulge you for a minute, I'll put a C square here. Okay? So this is, if I think of this as some nu square, this is just a harmonic oscillator equation with a frequency nu. So what it tells you is something more beautiful. Not only that the dynamical variables of a free electromagnetic field are essentially AKs, at every given point it just behaves like a harmonic oscillator. So electromagnetic field is just a bunch of harmonic oscillators. If you understand harmonic oscillators, you can understand free electromagnetic field. So keep this in mind because we will keep coming back to this idea. So this is how you reduce the dynamical variables here. Just as an aside, what are the dynamical variables in Newtonian gravity? So we did this for electromagnetism. What are the dynamical variables in Newtonian gravity? Newtonian gravity has no dynamical variables. It's an extraordinarily surprising result. There are no variables in Newtonian gravity which will satisfy a second order differential equation in time. If you take the Poisson equation, that is one reason Newtonian gravity is wrong. Okay, so if you take this and you write down the Poisson equation corresponding to it, this together would have given you del square phi is equal to 4 pi g, let me call 4 pi g as some constant mu times rho. This is what you would have got. Okay, now what all that I have done is to put this del phi here, remove this minus sign and minus sign, del square phi is 4 pi g, I have called 4 pi g as mu. So what does it give in Fourier space? In Fourier space, it will tell you minus k square, del square is minus k square, two operators of ik, phi k is equal to mu times rho k, where rho k is the Fourier transform of rho, phi k is the Fourier transform of this and k square. All of them are functions of time. Remember, here all these a's and b's in k space are functions of time, which tells you immediately that phi k at time t is nothing but minus mu rho k at time t divided by k square. So if you tell me the position of all the particles at a given instant in time, I can compute what is the density rho. Then I can do its Fourier transform and I can compute rho k. I can do it at any given time. Then the gravitational potential at that time is just given by this in Fourier space. It is just algebra. There is not even a differential equation. If I had used the sources here, then I would have ended up getting a source term on the right hand side. But I could not have if this equation, this was not there, then ak would have been that source divided by k square, if there is no time derivative. This time derivative is vital in electrodynamics. In the case of gravitational field, I had only del square, there was no time derivative. Therefore, no second order time derivative will come. So from our definition, Newtonian gravity has no dynamical degrees of freedom. There are no free gravitational waves in Newtonian gravity. We do know that there are gravitational waves, and that is because Newtonian gravity is not correct. And when you go to Einstein's theory, you get gravitational waves. So in electromagnetic theory, this problem was not there. Both of them existed in pre-1900s, you should remember that. So there was Newtonian gravity, which was very well developed, and Maxwell's equations were very well developed. And there was this structural difference between these two. Maxwell's equations have these wave solutions, but Newtonian gravity never had wave solutions, and nobody worried about it until special relativity came along. This also tells you that in Newtonian gravity, the gravitational potential at time t is immediately decided by the density at time t. So people call it instantaneous propagation and all that, but it is much easier to understand it in Fourier space. There are no free degrees of freedom. Once you tell me rho k, you have fixed the gravitational field. It is merely a question of scaling by k square in Fourier space. Everything becomes much simpler in Fourier space. And in Fourier space, here there is an equation like this with a second time derivative. Therefore, this is a dynamical variable. Well, this is not a dynamical variable because there are no second time derivative. So let us go a bit further. So this was the classical physics described by these things. And then we want to ask what went wrong with it. Several things went wrong, but one way of thinking about it is the following. Suppose you go from one frame to another frame in the days of classical physics. So what one is talking about is that within the context of those equations which are written down there, one is thinking about two frames of reference. This is the y-axis, this is the x-axis of one frame of reference. And there is another frame of reference which I will call, let us say x-bar and y-bar. And this frame is moving with some velocity v, uniform velocity v in this direction with respect to this. So if you take some point here, you will sort of say that because of common sense, this distance here is x bar, this distance here is x, and this distance here is, to that point, is x bar. So, I got it wrong. This is x bar and this is x. Okay, this distance is in the barred coordinate system, it is x bar, and this distance in the original unbarred coordinate system is x. So then your dear old common sense tells you that x bar is equal to x minus this distance, which is vt. It is the distance which the frame has traveled in time t. And all this is done at some time t, which is supposed to be the same for both. This is the absolute time. And you have one more equation just to make it precise, t bar equals t. Now, of course, in physics, we always have learned that common sense is wrong, and this is not true. So even though geometrically it looks as though this is how you should write, these equations are really not true. And in particular, this equation is not true. And that is where special relativity kicks in. But before we go to special relativity, we want to ask, is there some way of seeing that these equations are not true? It turns out that it is quite easy, and in fact, that is how it proceeded historically to a certain extent. If you take these transformations, you get a very interesting conclusion. If you go to the left-hand side of these equations, and if you look at x bar double dot, if you take the double dot of this, you get the double dot of this and a double dot of this. Double dot of this is 0 because it is linear in t. First derivative is constant, second derivative is 0. So this equation remains true, assuming f transforms in some sensible way. This equation remains true in both the frames. So this is called Galilean relativity in mechanics. That is, if I have two frames, let us say one car which is moving with uniform velocity with respect to another car, and you perform experiments on the ground or in one car which is not moving and another car which is moving with uniform velocity, then using mechanical experiments, you will never be able to say whether you are moving with uniform velocity or you are at rest. Okay? So it turns out that this principle is true even in special relativity, except that the transformations which you use are different. Now, you play the same game with the other set of equations you had in classical mechanics, classical physics. So this equation, fine, you make that transformation, it remains the same. So you can make the same transformations here. You can take t bar equals t and x bar equals x minus vt. You can calculate all the curls and divergences and all that. This is something which you guys should do once in your lifetime or look it up somewhere. If you do that, you don't know how E and B are going to change in a different frame. However you fool around with E and B, you will find that you cannot keep these equations invariant. While the mechanical equation of motion remain the same in both the frames, these equations will not remain the same. But there is a cheap trick by which you can understand that this will happen. So I will give you that cheap trick. The cheap trick is the following. Instead of taking second derivatives, suppose you took first derivatives, then this will tell you that the velocity of a particle in this frame is the velocity of the particle in this frame minus capital V. Okay? I mean, the whole thing works even if there is a vector sign here. Now, we didn't use what kind of velocity we are talking about. It is just the path of that particle which is required. So, you take the path of light, you can define a velocity for light. Light goes from one point to another and you can define a velocity for light. You have a car moving, its headlights are moving in this direction, tail lights are moving in this direction. The headlights will move with a velocity of light plus the velocity of the car. Tail light will move with a velocity of the light minus the velocity of the car. So these equations' validity immediately implies this. While if you fool around with these equations, you will find that the electromagnetic radiation, which arises out of Maxwell's equation, always move to the speed of light, which is equal to c, which is a parameter in that theory. Okay, so that doesn't change. So you clearly expect a conflict between these transformations and the Maxwell's equations, and it was noticed. It was noticed that there is a problem. So of course, physicists are by and large very conservative. So the first fix they came up with is that, okay, maybe when we are studying electromagnetism, we should use a different transformations, and when we are doing mechanics, you should use these transformations. And this man, Lorentz, wrote down a set of transformations under which this Maxwell equation will remain invariant. So that is how the Lorentz transformations came into being. But that immediately runs into trouble because electromagnetism and mechanical particles are not separate systems. So if I have a bunch of charged particles which are moving around and producing electromagnetic field, in order to, and acted upon by the electromagnetic force, then in order to do physics with these particles, the particle side, the left hand side, has to transform in one particular way, and the electric and magnetic fields here and the electromagnetic part of it has to transform in a different way, and that will run into inconsistencies. So Einstein solved this whole problem by saying that no, these equations are not right, we shouldn't be using it for anything. Okay? And that is how you wrote down the special relativistic transformation laws. For our purpose, I am not going to do special relativity for our in this lectures, but for our purpose, we need a few relations from special relativity, which I will develop first. So let me do it here. The main result which we need is the following. Suppose I have a space-time. This is time, and this is space. This is some inertial frame. All the three axes are put together here. One should have written CT for dimensional consideration, but C is 1. So suppose I have a clock which moves along some trajectory here. This is a clock. And take a time interval here, which we will call dt. And during that dt, it has traveled a distance dx, all measured in this frame. So we want to know what is the time difference of the clock between this and this. What is the reading difference? So it's a very physical question. I have a clock which is moving like this, and it was here, and then it was here. The time difference is dt, time length difference is dx. What is the clock reading going differences going to be? Now, what special relativity tells you is that the clock difference dta, the whole square, will be dt square minus the distance traveled, which is dx square upon c square. So if the clock was not moving, the second time is absent. So two clocks which are at rest with respect to each other, they will show the same time run. When c goes to infinity, the second time is absent. So in the classical limit, the dt square and dt square are the same. Otherwise, this is the form. Okay? So this is one key result in special relativity which you have. And usually you can write this as dt square minus v square by c square dt square, because dx square is v square dt square. So this becomes dt square. So this is the way you would have learned time dilation, that the moving clock slows down compared to the stationary clock. This also tells you that there is a nice invariant quantity, and this quantity happens to be invariant for all kinds of coordinate transformations. This quantity doesn't change between two frames. What do I mean by that? There is a clock which was moving like this. The clock had some reading here and some reading here, 12 o'clock and 12 time. What readings that clock had at these two points doesn't depend on frame of reference. Of course, the difference between that, if you compare it with another coordinate system, that depends on which coordinate system you are using. But dta is an invariant quantity because that is the clock time shown in the face of the clock. Okay? Therefore, I can write a quantity which I will call ds square, which is just c square dta square. And when c is equal to 1, they are the same. That is c square dt square minus dx square. So this is dx square, dy square, dz square subtract. So this is almost like a Pythagorean addition, except that there's a minus sign here. And this quantity will play an important role in special relativity and even in our discussion when we study action principle and all that. Okay. So this is as far as this part of the life is concerned. We have done electrodynamics, we have done special relativity, we have done classical mechanics. So what does GR do to this? What happens when you introduce the gravitational field? I want to tell you what happens when we introduce gravitational field, and then we will break for the day. This equation, so first let me give you the answer, and then I will motivate it for you. This equation can be written in a slightly more formal way as eta AB dxA dxB. Was anything like this introduced in any of the previous lectures? You are familiar with it. I don't have to explain it. Fine. So this eta AB just stands for a second rank tensor, but you can think of it as a matrix. Its diagonal elements are 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1 in this coordinate system. And this DXA, this A goes 0, 1, 2, 3, and there is a summation assumed over A and B. What GR does is to change it into an equation where you replace this by GAB, which depends on T and X, DXA, DXB. That is, instead of just minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, you put a bunch of functions here. G00 into dt square plus G11 into dx square plus G11 into dx square plus G22 into dy square, etc. You can also have a G01 into dt dx1. So there are 10 functions here because this is symmetric. It's a symmetric 4x4 matrix. So diagonal 4 plus another 6, so 10 functions here. These 10 functions describe gravity. Fortunately for our lectures, we don't need this. But you just remember that the presence of gravity, the distance between two events in the space-time, is modified from this equation to this equation. Now, this is something important, and this is, let me spend a moment stressing that. There was no notion of distance between two events in pre-relativistic physics. So an event, by definition, is something which has a time and space associated with it. Let me call it P. P has a time and it has three spatial coordinates. If I drop the chalk, the place where the chalk drops and when it drops, these are four numbers. That is what defines an event. Now, once I have an event, I can take another event, which is, let us say, Q or P bar, which will have T bar and X bar. And I can ask, what is the distance between these two events? Such a notion is not well defined in Newtonian theory. And there are complicated ways of doing it, but there is no natural definition in Newtonian theory. These complicated ways come from special relativity. Knowing what is done, you can create some mathematical structures. So we won't go into it. But by and large, in Newtonian theory, there is a very well defined notion in space. If I take two points in space, the distance between them is dx square plus dy square plus dz square square root. Now, why is it that? Why is it not dx 4 plus dy 4 plus dz 4 fourth root? Nobody knows the answer. Okay? It just so happens that dx square plus dy square plus dz square square root works. And that is what we have intuitively understood. And that is the so-called Euclidean geometry with Pythagorean theorem and things like that. Now, what happens in the presence of gravitational field is that this geometry gets changed and the notion of distance gets changed. This had already happened in special relativity. The special relativity already gives you a way of defining distance between two events. So let me make it very formal. The distance between two events P and P bar is going to be integral over ds from P to P bar. This is integral P to P bar of eta AB, some DXA by D lambda, DXB by D lambda, square root D lambda. So this is just a parameter. You take a curve. You take this curve to be xa of lambda. So there is a value lambda which changes along this. And you have defined a curve in space-time. So there is a t of lambda, x of lambda, y of lambda, z of lambda, four functions. Then you can compute this quantity and integrate. This is actually what you do in geometry when you take the length of an arc. So this distance is defined in special relativity but not in classical physics. And in classical physics, it degenerates into spatial distances. Now, you can do the same thing in general relativity by just replacing this eta by this g. So the geometrical distances between the events get changed. First of all, we have a notion of a distance in space-time. And the distance is given by this expression. The main result which we need for the purpose of our talk is that we will only do weak gravitational fields. In the presence of weak gravitational field, the ds square which I wrote down here can be written in the following form. It is 1 plus 2 times the gravitational potential by c square dt square minus dx square. So what have I done? Look at this formula. This is what special relativity tells you. I had just multiplied by the c square dt square by a factor. That factor is 1 plus twice the gravitational potential upon c square. So you know from things like escape velocity that the gravitational potential has the dimensions of square of the velocity. So 5 by c square is a dimensionless number. You should go and compute 5 by c square for air, sun, a few things, and you will find that this is fairly tiny. Okay? So this is a small correction to this one, and in a weak gravitational field, this is the ds square you need. How do I know this? Of course, there are various ways of deriving it, but for the purpose of this lecture, I will just give you again a quick and dirty derivation of this. It's actually quite rigorous. But in order to make it rigorous, I have to explain a lot of things like principle of equivalence, etc., which I won't go into. But I'll just give you the nutshell of this. The nutshell comes from the following fact. Suppose you have a clock. So here we have introduced this clocks and the trajectory of the clock. Now suppose a clock is not moving. Then this formula will tell you, the formula we wrote down here will tell you, if the clock is not moving, dx square is 0. Dt square is equal to theta square. So you have two clocks which are stationary with respect to each other, one on top of the table, one at the bottom. They will show the same time, is what special relativity tells you. Let us do the same thing here. Put dx equals 0. The phi is the gravitational potential which depends on the position. What it tells you is that the time flow depends on in what gravitational potential you are located. So if I have a clock on the table and clock at the bottom, which is at a deeper gravitational potential, will run slower. Gravity affects the flow of time. Actually, this is the important result in general relativity. Everything else is, in some sense, window dressing. If you are very clever and your technique is good, you can get the rest of it from that. Okay, but this is the main result which you need. Now, why does gravity affect the flow of time? Well, you can prove it using two arguments, I mean, using two components. First component is that if a clock is moving, it gets affected. The clock rate gets affected by velocity, that we know. The second thing is something called principle of equivalence. What the principle of equivalence tells you is that if you have two situations, so there is a situation where you have Earth and you have some box here and you perform some experiments inside this box, and the second you take an identical box and you attach a rocket ship to it. Here there is a Newtonian gravity G acting here, and you blast this off in interstellar space with an acceleration G, and you perform the same experiment here. Okay, then the results of the experiment will be the same. This is what principle of equivalence tells you, as long as the sizes of the boxes are sufficiently small. For example, suppose I have two balls here, one 5 kilogram ball and one 10 kilogram ball. And I also have a 5 kilogram ball and a 10 kilogram ball here. I want to know how it will fall here. I don't know that, but I know what happens here. Here, if I am in this rocket ship and you take a 5 kilogram ball and a 10 kilogram ball and let go, they will not move. This is an interstellar space, no force is acting on them, they will sit there. But the floor of the cabin will come and hit it. And the floor of the cabin will hit it simultaneously. Therefore, the guy who is inside will think that both the balls fell down simultaneously, irrespective of its mass. So he will find then that here also the balls has to fall down simultaneously, irrespective of its mass. So because the equations of motion in classical physics says mass times acceleration, the acceleration is what determines simultaneity or not of the fall, is equal to force. And it cannot depend on mass. If I put M1 and M2 in the same F, X dot has to be the same. This immediately tells you that this F has to be M times something else. And this M has to cancel. And that is precisely what we did here. We put this M. This M, if it is M star, different from this M, you are in trouble. So the principle of equivalence can also be stated by saying that the gravitational mass is same as the inertial mass. Again, we don't have time to go into it. But basically, the fact is that these two are identical, which means what goes on in the gravitational field can be understood if I know what goes on in a moving frame with an acceleration. And moving frame in an acceleration, I can understand using special relativity. Because all motion changes the clock rates, therefore, gravitational field has to change the clock rate. All that remains is that the formula has to be like this. That also is trivial. So let me show it to you in a very simple context. So this is the Earth, and you keep some clocks. So these are clocks on the wall. Put one here, put one there, okay, on the vertical direction. So there is a gravitational field G here. Now you take another clock, and let that clock fall freely in this gravitational field starting from infinity. It is just falling down. Now, a freely falling clock does not experience gravity. That is almost by definition, because the gravitational field is completely neutralized by that. Only when it is resisting gravity, it feels the gravity, and there is no gravitational field. So I can use special theory of relativity as far as this guy is concerned, the guy who is freely falling with this clock. Okay? So this clock is, let us say, crossing this clock at some time. And at that time, just infinitesimally, this shows some reading, which I will call dt of the freely falling clock. Now, this guy who is in a freely falling frame can use special theory of relativity. So he sees this clock going up with a particular velocity. So he will say that there is a relationship between these two, which is 1 minus v square by c square times dt square of this clock, which I will call A. No, sorry, the other way around. Okay, so this clock is moving up with some velocity. So that velocity square by c square is what he will say is related to this. But what is v square? This is a freely falling clock from infinity. So you just use energy conservation. Half v square of the clock plus the gravitational potential of the clock is equal to the initial velocity, which was 0, and initial gravitational potential, which was 0, because it is falling from infinity. So you plug that back here, you get this dt square of this clock in a gravitational field is 1 plus 2 phi by c square dt square of the freely falling clock. Because I just substituted for v square as 2 phi with a minus sign. That is exactly what this is. Compare these two. Now, you just have to give meaning for this freely falling clock time. That is easy. Freely falling clock time is the clock time in the absence of gravitational field. So, this is at phi is equal to 0. So, you might as well write this as dt square at phi is equal to 0. This is dt square at some phi. So, if you have clocks at different gravitational potentials, the rates will be scaled by this 1 plus 2 phi by c square. What if these clocks are also moving? I don't keep one clock on the table, one clock on the ground. I also make them move. Then, of course, special relativity will contribute a v square by c square factor to it. That will come from the second term. So the overall time difference shown by a clock in a gravitational field has one contribution due to gravitational potential and another contribution due to velocity. By reversing the same argument, now we will say that the distance between two points in the presence of a gravitational field has to be replaced with this by G, and this ds has to be replaced by this ds. This is this ds, and this is the GAB corresponding to this. What is that? That is again diagonal. First term is not 1, it is 1 plus 2 phi by c square. Other three diagonal terms are minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. So this is all I need as a background material, and now we will go further and talk about where action principles fit into this overall scheme of things.